Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Like I said, I'm digital lead of ABB here in Finland, not quite the whole country, but I'm going to talk about the digital factor of the future, but I put the discussion a little bit in the bigger context here. And just as an introduction first, I've been around in this industrial digitalization all my career, and actually been 25 years now at ABB in various roles, ranging from platform technology development to actually concretely even hands-on doing some stuff 20+ years ago. And then just lately, last 2 years, I've been looking after our digitalization journey with the whole portfolio that we have as digital lead of the country organization here. So it is more about kind of the customer facing and looking at how do we help our customers digitalize their operations. But a little bit of a background. You probably know ABB, all of you, from various angles, but we've been actually quite a while around this topic. So if you look at kind of what we are now today in the fourth industrial revolution era. But it all actually started by the second industrial revolution. And what was actually the driver there was that we introduced the electric motion as a productivity driver in the industry. So it used to be like that, okay, you have a factory, you have handwork, it's kind of artisan type of a way of producing things, and then, okay, steam engines and the like. But then the big change came when we started electrifying this. And at the time already, actually around the same time we had this development, we also had the first electric motion or electric transportation development. So it's actually not so we talk a lot about the electric vehicles today, but actually, if you think about it started here over 200 years ago. So it was all about electricity. The third industrial revolution in the previous century now, what was the driver there was that actually computers entered the manufacturing area. And what we had as first here, and where ABB has been a major driver with, is that we had the industrial automation developments started by having programmable controllers and then later on distributed control systems, and with those automate the industrial processes more on a systemic level. The other thing where ABB has been a trailblazer is robotics, and everybody must have seen the industrial welding robots that totally revolutionized that particular industry. And now we are in the fourth industrial revolution. So what's now different here is that, of course, digitalization is playing kind of a bigger and bigger role. And in ABB's case, we talk about ABB Ability as kind of our kind of a term for that. But there are still a lot of the same things still actually affecting this. So we have still increasing electrification of all, basically all processes, all, let's say, the forms of energy mostly being driven by electricity. So that continues to prevail. But then what we have more is that we have kind of everything linked to everything. So that is today's change in the system. And okay, you see a couple of examples where ABB today is very active in. We are the leading electric vehicle infrastructure provider. So when you need to electrify road transport, for instance, and the charging infrastructure, build charging infrastructure to support that, ABB is the world leading player there. And then the other example is the ABB YuMi robot there, where we have now robots starting to work side by side with humans. And I will end my presentation on that aspect. So where we are now today very active is that how do we combine the automated way of working? So how do we combine machines, for instance, in a factory working side by side with humans without having to put the robot in a cage? That opens up totally new possibilities for this. So why do we, okay, I'm still okay, looking at the, what we from ABB do. So we've been traditionally a product solution vendor building systems. But where we need to now engage with is that you actually have to be working together already from when you design an industrial facility. So starting from planning a factory, for instance. Then, okay, we still continue to be, of course, very active here, but then the operation doesn't end when you build something. You have to actually think about the whole life cycle. And where now the digital thread needs to be also considered is that it actually links these phases, starting from the design, going all the way to actual operations. So you have, we talk about life cycle digital twin type of an approach where you have to consider these aspects from the beginning and then continue carrying that information throughout the life cycle. And that of course links with now OPC UA and how do we model these things in such a way that we can from the beginning simulate, then carry that configuration information through the building phase and then use the same capabilities in the operations. So why we need to do this? Actually, here is a picture where I try to kind of put the whole world in and where do we have a change today. I would argue that digitalization and electrification of this entire system, they are keys for actually having sustainable development here. So if we consider what is happening in the energy system, everybody knows about kind of climate change drivers, and we know that the energy generation is transforming much more to be driven by renewables. So we have solar and wind power actually being the largest. When we look at today electricity generation, they are actually the largest increments today already. So most of the energy that we produce more, it's actually coming out of those sources. And what makes that interesting, or I would say creates a challenge, is that of course it is good for sustainability point of view because it's renewable, but it's also much harder to control than traditional way of generating electricity. So if you in the past had a kind of a one big power plant and somebody planned how to run it, today you have to consider that you have very much distributed electricity generation, and then you have many more consumers and producers that need to interact in this. So it's actually a systemic change here. If we think about the industry, today's topic, what is now Industry 4.0, it's also driven by changes in these demand patterns that we have for the goods that we produce. So if you today think about kind of, if I want to have some product to my tastes, I can go online and find it basically, it used to be like that you had mass production somewhere in the world, a big factory producing these things, and then they get transported to me. But today's paradigm can also be that I have flexible manufacturing and like a lot size one type of a production, and then it means that I have to dynamically reconfigure the production to produce this individualized demand pattern. So it's driving the creating a need for this type of a flexibility. And what we then need to do is that we need to create this type of new reconfigurable systems. And again, here standards like OPC UA for interoperability, they play a key role for us to achieve this. I would also point out that these two areas, they are interconnected. So if you today think about that I'm producing, let's consider I have a kind of a heavy process industry factory here, which is consuming a lot of electrical energy. And at the same time, we have here a kind of a fluctuating demand pattern or kind of production pattern that is determined by the weather. So when the wind is blowing hard and we have a sunny day, we get actually a lot of renewable energy coming into the grid. And for instance, in Germany today, that is already today a situation that sometimes you have so much electrical energy coming into the grid that it causes the price of the electricity to be momentarily negative. So we actually get paid for consuming the electricity. What it means for if I'm in the industry, if I have this heavy consumption possibility, it totally changes the way I from financial point of view need to operate the production, because now actually it's a good thing to consume the electricity and to store it in the output of my production facility, and then it means that I actually have to be able to consider, for instance, the real-time energy prices and availability in how I run my factory. And then last but not least, we have our built infrastructure around us. So developments about smart cities, for instance. So how things are interconnected there. How is the whole mobility and transportation paradigm changing? And then how it needs to be driven, like if you consider, for instance, how does a modern healthcare facility look like, or what are the modern digital factories, the data centers. They are the key ingredients on this side, but again, they are interconnected with all of this. So what I'm saying with this, that everything is actually connected with everything. And for us, because it's so much more dynamic today, so you have this this situation that you have to kind of cope with these interconnections, cope with these fast changes, there is no way a human being can actually do this in a planned fashion. So it means that we have to drive much more towards autonomous type of an automation paradigm so that these subsystems can interact with each other and then adapt to the changes that are occurring in this environment, which then means that first of all, you have to have semantic interoperability between these subsystems, but then also it calls for kind of a digitalization and artificial intelligence type of autonomous operations, because you can't have human in the loop with these fast changes. So that is why we need these developments. And then if we then consider kind of how things are today, so let's ask ourselves kind of, is our current way of working good enough for this? And my argument is that the way we are building these systems, a traditional way of building these systems, actually can't cope with the requirements that we have in this environment. I show you why. Today, let's consider building a factory. How it happens today is that you start by process design. You kind of lay the groundwork. This is the type of factory I want to have. These are the control concepts. This is kind of the big picture. Somebody does that, either end customer themselves or you engage a process consultant to kind of design the plant. And then you basically need to nail it down, because you can't keep the degrees of freedom open for the next steps. You hand over this basic design to designers of the subsystems or OEMs that provide the various parts of it. And here in this example, I'm considering kind of a chemical plant where we have a lot of pumping type of subsystems. So somebody designs those subsystems, and then eventually they call companies like ABB or other component manufacturers. That okay, I now need this type of component in my subsystem. So please quote that to us. And then a third party again puts the things together. The challenge is that this is a waterfall, and at every stage, what has happened is that you actually add a little bit of safety margin in the design. So I rather put a little bit a bigger motor there so that it can cope with the dynamics of the process, and the end result is that when you have then a combined system, it is actually typically quite far away from what would be the optimum efficiency for the design. And it's just caused by this that, okay, we do this in a sequential fashion. Further on, actually, it gets worse, because if you think about this plant in the end, it need to operate in this dynamic environment. So what were the assumptions that I took here? What is actually the design paradigm? Did I build for flexibility, or do I kind of design it for a particular operating point? Very often you design it for a kind of maximum operating point. And then it causes this first of all, these safety margins to be added, but then further on, actually, the whole system is rigid in a way that it's very difficult to kind of adapt it to the changing conditions going forward. So this is obviously not kind of the way to go. And what we want to do now, we actually want to use the digital way of, or the fact that we actually have the digital way here, to build a new way of building these plants. And we, for instance, have digital twins of all these components, and we can model the process. And then what about if we put together the right parties around this environment and simulated the various scenarios? And that is what we are now driving towards, so that rather than having a waterfall type of a way of building this, we bring together the We bring together the process models. We bring together the scenarios of how I want to run this plant. So it's kind of dynamics on that level. We bring together the equipment and subsystems, and then we simulate the various scenarios. How we could make, for instance, the equipment selection. So what type of pump should I put there together? What type of drivetrain? And obviously, in the past, you had to actually do this in a waterfallish type of way, because you had a manual engineering work here. You can't financially, in a financially sustainable way, do this type of iteration. But now that we digitalize this, and now that we can actually automate this cycle, it opens up totally new possibility to optimize these designs, because the marginal cost of running one more iteration is actually coming close to zero. What does it need then? It obviously needs interoperability standards. So we have to be able to make these things talk to each other, and it has to be able to be connected over the life cycle of the plant. But it also requires a new way of working here. So what we talk about is that we want to build a kind of collaborative way of designing, building, and operating these facilities. And it starts by having the right parties in the design phase joining together around the digital representation of the plant in order to optimize the design. But then you, of course, doesn't make sense that you just stop there. You then go and you build the plant. It gives you benefits of optimizing the whole plant build process, which then leads to accelerated ramp up of the plant. So if you can make the big factory come online 2 months earlier than in the traditional waterfall type of a project, that is of course huge benefit for whoever is going to build the plant. The time to profit is increased. And then we don't stop there when the plant is finished, but we want to continue with collaborative operations, which is then optimizing the process, optimizing the way how we run it together with the same parties that in the beginning designed it. And then out of that comes, of course, learning, so that when we do the next designs, then how do we can further optimize these things. So that's the theory. Here is the practice. So this is an example case. It's actually a trivial example case where we have a very simple chemical plant, where we have one tank or reactor vessel, and then two pumps pumping some kind of a liquid in the process. And then on the right we have the power system, electrical system that drives drives these pumps and supplies the energy to do this run this process. And now, because we have a tank there, it is actually a dynamic process. So you can, based on how you control, how you run the plant, how you run the pumps, you can affect, or you can basically play with that how much you have in that tank reservoir, where is the kind of how much you use the buffer. It affects the way how you need to run the pumps. And what we have done here, we have actually simulated two scenarios. So we have, first of all, the process simulation done, and then we have the corresponding electrical simulation. And what we have included here are components from multiple parties. So the process simulation comes from a process supplier, and then here these boxes represent our virtual drive components integrated into process simulation. So drive is controlling the motor, and then we basically can choose in a collaborative fashion. We can choose what type of a drive we, for instance, put there, what type of motors we need, what type of pumps we need. And what we have done here, we have simulated two scenarios. One, first scenario is a traditional waterfall. So let's size this equipment in such a way that they can cope with the peak demand, peak flow need of the outbound pumping. So we don't use the buffer actually cope with the fluctuation, but we just make sure that we have big enough equipment, and it's a typical over-dimensioning. And then the second scenario is that we look at what type of control strategy we could apply with the demand pattern that we have for the outflow, and then size the equipment so that they are adequate, taking into account the control strategy there. It leads to smaller, or our hypothesis is that we can actually cope with the needs with smaller equipment. And these are indeed the scenarios. So there are let's say smaller motors here and a little bit different drive configuration. And then what we want to look at is that we simulate the entire power grid energy consumption, and we look at how much power we are drawing from the grid through the transformer. So here we didn't actually yet take that into account, that we could also potentially put the smaller transformer here. But so we assume that, okay, we just play with the sizes of those motors. And what we run now is a simulation of this type of a demand pattern. So this is a pumping 4-hour production scenario where there are couple of half hour times where we need more outflow into the process, so the pump outbound pump is pumping a little bit more, and then this type of average consumption. And let's see then what the outcome is. So here is a concrete demo of what is occurring. On the right we have the process simulation. So you see kind of what is the flow and what is the pressure and the like. And then we have these virtual drives connected to this process. And on the left here we see kind of inside of the virtual drive what is the current and what's the power that the drive is drawing from the grid. And then with this information we calculate the entire grid needs. Key point here from integration point of view is that we have now integrated components from, or digital twins from multiple parties that don't have any kind of direct connection with each other, and we have a co-simulation scenario where these components seamlessly work together. End result is actually very, very interesting. So we look at, first of all, scenario one. So we need this much of electric power drawn from the grid, and then it leads to specific energy consumption of 0.67 kilowatt hours per cubic meter of liquid pumped. And then we can in scenario two we can actually consume less because we run the system in a more closer to actual optimum operating point. But it's an interesting thing that now if I were the investor that is building this plant, this would be actually double benefit because I can save in my capital expenditure. I can do away with, I can run the same capability of the plant. I need 20%, 25% less money spent on building the factory, and still it is actually 10% more energy efficient over the life cycle. And this shows the kind of, there's an obvious business case of doing this. And when we talk with our customers about this, this is actually, these numbers get them thrilled to try new things. Okay, now we have built the plant and it's designed to be optimum. I'm going to end my presentation with a concrete example of what is digital factory of the future today. And this is a case example which we achieved this summer here in Helsinki in our Trice factory. We had the first industrial artificial intelligence application applied in a production facility that used the 5G telecom standard to kind of support the operation. What we have here is a real-time quality control application, which is using video analytics to look at the assembly of our Trice modules in the factory, and it is implemented as a cloud-hosted or hybrid cloud application. So not the traditional on-prem locally next to the equipment, but rather running in a data center type of a service, which then uses the 5G communication to take the data from the camera and then to provide the feedback. And concretely how it works is that we have a high resolution video camera watching over the shoulder of the person when he is assembling the product. We know from the master data of the production what is the variant that I'm producing, and then this machine vision, or let's say the data stream that we get out of this, gets transported, beamed up to data center where we have our analytical application running using the 5G network. And here we need actually 5G because the uplink is, there is quite a high bandwidth requirement on the uplink of this communication when we take the raw data stream from the camera into the data center. Then we run the analytics and we give instantaneous feedback to the person that is assembling this work. And with that, we can then achieve the 100% quality coverage. And here it is. I'll mute the sound. So what it's doing, okay, this is our Trice factory here in Helsinki. And here we have the R&D and our flagship factory for this equipment. Here is the assembly work, and you can see there on the top now that we get kind of a augmented reality feedback to the person immediately. So analytics is looking that, okay, do I put the right pieces in the right order, in the right position? And based on that, it gives feedback visually over the live data stream of what is the outcome. And then we also look at kind of the other parts of this. So for instance, how the each screw is tightened, so what is the torque of it. And then again, give feedback for the person that we do this right. This particular job is such that actually human person is the optimum for this job, so it doesn't make sense to robotize this job yet. But what we are looking to do is that how do we, with the help of these type of autonomous applications, how can we augment the human with their work? And when we talk about now, for instance, we are here with OPC UA, the question is that, for instance, in a 5G network, when we have microservices architecture for these type of applications, and then I want to scale this application so that I next day when I have it first working here in Helsinki, I want to run it in Mumbai in our factory. How do I implement this in such a way that that it's kind of instantaneous scaling? So it calls for this, that we have first of all the software architecture such that they are not just local systems running locally, but we have to have this type of a hybrid cloud type of a scenario. And then it also calls for this integration standard. So if we from the beginning looked at how do we simulate things together, that would be one requirement for further development of integration standards such as OPC UA. But here we have another use case that how do we, for instance, cope with the needs of the such an application that we can, in a standard way, model the production process and the product that we are making, and then, for instance, have this type of unconventional data streams such as video being used here, and then derive semantic outcomes out of that. So we interpret the videos, a raw video stream, and then basically can tell that what is the is the product now correctly assembled or not. So with that, I would like to close my presentation, and if you have any comments or questions, I would be happy to discuss that with you.